morning. Welcome to the Open Church, Open Bible, Church School Hour here at Christ Baptist Church. Thank you for joining us again this morning. And I'm sure you are still excited over the lesson that was taught last week by Minister Marosa Davis. Thank God for her creativity and the way she approached the lesson. And we're praising God for the overview. She will overview one week, I'll overview the next week. And these overviews will continue over time. And we're thanking you for just joining in and listening. Let us open in prayer. God, we thank you for this day. This is another day that you have made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you, Father, for our sleep last night. Thank you for our early rise this morning. And as we come to this place of study in you, everyone who has their Bible, Lord, and we're our Sunday school books, and we're ready to learn about you. Help us now, God, by the power of your Spirit and the Word, to get closer to you through knowledge. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our lesson this week, in the quarter, we're coming quickly to the end of a quarter. But on this lesson tonight, we're going to look at a light for the Gentiles. A light for the Gentiles. I'm going to ask you to get your Bibles and turn to Isaiah chapter 49. And we're going to read verses 1 through 10 together. Isaiah, the 49th chapter, verses 1 through 10. We're starting to read at verse number 1. Listen, O coastlands, to me, and take heed, ye peoples from afar. The Lord has called me from the womb, from the matrix of my mother. He has made mention of my name. And he has made my mouth like a sharp sword. In the shadow of his hand he has hidden me, and made me a polished shaft. In his quiver he has hidden me. And he said to me, you are my servant, O Israel, in whom I will be glorified. Then I said, I have labored in vain. I have spent my strength for nothing and in vain. Yet surely my just reward is with the Lord, and my work with my God. And now the Lord says, who formed me from the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob back to him, so that Israel is gathered to him. For I shall be glorious in the eyes of the Lord, and my God shall be my strength. Indeed, he says, it is too small a thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the preserved ones of Israel. I will also give you as a light to the Gentiles, that you should be my salvation to the ends of the earth. Thus says the Lord, the Redeemer of Israel, their Holy One, to him whom man despises, to him whom the nations abhor, to the servant of rulers, kings shall see and rise. Princes also shall worship, because of the Lord who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel, and he has chosen you. Thus says the Lord, in an acceptable time I have heard you, and in the day of salvation I have helped you. I will preserve you and give you as a covenant to the people to restore the earth, to cause them to inherit the desolate heritages. That you may say to the prisoners, go forth, to those who are in darkness, show yourselves. They shall feed along the roads, and their pastures shall be on all desolate heights. They shall neither hunger nor thirst, neither heat nor sun shall strike them. For he who has mercy on them will lead them, even by the springs of water he will guide them. This ends our reading. From the beginning, God has had a global intent, a universal purpose to all the dwellers that would be a part of his kingdom. And God made it known from the very beginning that it would come from all nations, all kindreds, and all tongues. Christ, he died for the sins of the whole world, John 3:16. He didn't just die for a certain group of people. He died for everyone. 1 John 2:2, and he himself is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the whole world. Propitiation is a term that includes both atonement and expiation. Jesus died as an atonement for our sins and to expiate, to take away the penalties that were due for those sins. Everyone who believes in Jesus is assured of eternal life with the guarantee that he's going to love them. He gave his life out of love. From the foundation of the world, Israel was called to be the vehicle by which the good news would spread throughout the whole world. God chose this tiny little nation, Israel, that they would be a medium by which he would bring forth his son, the Christ. In Genesis chapter 12, verse 3, God said to Abram, I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Now, I want you to know that's no bromide, that we have to be kind to Israel, though we should be kind to them because they are a people who are creatures of God. We should be. We should love them. But this is not a formula that we can have blessings if we treat Israel right. That's a wrong teaching from this text. This text is a promise to Abraham that God is going to do something great to everyone that comes out of his lineage. And you and I are sons of Abraham in spirit, not in blood. Just as all mankind was subject to the curse that fell because of Adam's sin, even so, all mankind will be influenced by the blessing that is bestowed because of God and the promises he gave to Abraham. There's blessings that are bestowed on that faith that Abraham had. We become friends of God with having the same faith that Abraham had. And what was true of Abraham was true of all of his descendants, the Israelites, and you and I. Therefore, the Lord Jesus is the fulfillment of the promises to Israel. Jesus, as God, we read in our scripture this morning in Isaiah 49, he is the great light to the Gentiles. We see this appearing four times in Isaiah besides our text. We see it also in Isaiah 49:6. We see it in 42:6. We see it in Luke 2:32. He is the light to the Gentiles who brings healing. He's a light to the Gentiles, to the world. He brings peace and he brings blessings to all the people of the earth. And all we have to do is have faith and believe in him. Unfortunately, though, the nation of Israel continually failed in fulfilling its role as being the holy vessel that God wanted to use. It was to be a servant role for them. They were to be the ones that would be the harbingers of truth that would bring forth Messiah. They were God's witness to the world, and repeatedly they forsook that responsibility. Although the nation Israel has not given into God's plan, God still had a definitive restorative plan. You see, God didn't make this up on the fly. God already had this plan in place from the foundation of the world. He knew that Israel would deny to fulfill the role that he had given them. So God had a plan that his son would come. The proper understanding of John chapter 6, verse 37 is, all that the Father giveth me shall arrive at me, and him that is on the way. That's the proper understanding. The King James says, and him that comes. But the real understanding is of him that is on the way. That's Gentiles, that's you and I will in no wise cast out. Jesus says, God has given me Jew and Gentile. He's given me all kinds of people that will become followers of me. So therefore, no one who trusts in Christ and loves him will be left out. There's a joy, there's a shout in that all men have to do is believe that Jesus is God's son and that he paid a sacrifice on a cross and that he raised from the dead, and that if I trust him and believe in him, his love has already made provisions for me to be restored to a fellowship with God. What a great story that is. A marvelous understanding of the reason why Christ sent this light to the Gentiles. This lesson is broken down into three parts. First part of today's lesson is Messiah as the servant of the Lord. Isaiah chapter 49, verses 1 through 4. He's the servant. 41:9-1 begins with the second of what is called the servant songs in the book of Isaiah. The other songs are in 42, verses 1 through 9, chapter 50, verses 4 through 11, chapter 52, and chapter 53. Actually starts at 52. At the end of 52, all the way into 53, verse 12. The servant songs. Jesus came to be a servant. And the mention of the word aisles in verse number 1 extends the scope of Messiah's calling for people. Isles is a word that means islands or distant lands, or is a term that is used for Gentiles. If God's relationship was solely to Israel, what right did God's servant have to address the Gentile nations with such authority? So we see then that God, his relationship, his role, was not just to Israel, but it was to all people. And the answer lies in the fact that from his birth, that is, he was called by God to his ministry. Jeremiah 1:5. When God calls you to a ministry, even if you're trying to escape it, to run from it, he'll catch you. He says, before I formed you in Jeremiah. We learn the same thing in Galatians chapter 1, verse 15. Before I formed you. So he was called by God to his ministry. And whenever God calls a people to a ministry, God prepares them for ministry. God prepared him like a sharp sword and a polished arrow. The writer in Hebrews says the word of God is like a two-edged sword that cuts going in and cuts going out, dividing to asunder from the spirit and bone and marrow. Jesus was called a prepared word from God. He was a sharp sword that God would use. He came both as servant and he came as a warrior. And we have to understand each one of the timings of those roles. He is God our servant. He's God the warrior, serving those who trust him and ultimately judging those who resist him. So we can make a choice. I can hear him, listen to what he says, and obey what he says, and I become a servant of his. Or I can repulse him, repel him, push back, and therefore I end up fighting against him. He becomes a warrior. All of God's servants should be prepared weapons. Verse 2. Robert McChaney, 19th century Scottish theologian, says, it is not great talents God blesses so much as great likeness to Jesus. A holy minister, servant, is an awful weapon in the hand of God. Thank you, Mr. McChaney. God can take the least and make it a great weapon. It's not how much ability we have. It's not how smart we are. It's not how tall we are. It's not how strong we are. It's that when we take on the likeness of Christ, we become holy servants in the hand of God. What a weapon God has when he has a humble servant who is willing to do his bidding and not doubt, not equivocate in faithlessness. The Jewish nation was called to glorify God and to be a light to the Gentiles, but they fail. So God promises to send a Messiah, verse number 3, which Israel could not do. God says, I'm going to send somebody to do what you, my people, I originally called you to do. Now today, the church is God's light. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Then he says, you are the light of the world. The church is God's light in this dark world. And prayerfully, we're going to do the job effectively. Prayerfully, he's not going to have to find somebody else to do what he's called us to do. Which brings us to the question, what is our commitment to evangelism? We have abandoned evangelism for the large part because things have changed. We used to go around knocking on doors, can't do that anymore. We used to go and hand out tracts in the mall, they don't like solicitations. But does that mean we stop? Does that mean we quit? We just give up when God has called us to be a light in the midst of darkness? Sending Messiah was not a responsive act on the part of God. The all-knowing, omniscient God knew that Israel would fail, and he knew who would reject him. And so he sent Messiah from the foundation of the world. It was determined that he would come. Since God is neither arbitrary, that is impulsive, or capricious, unpredictable, the servant of the Lord declares that his mission is no afterthought. He makes it clear in the writings of Isaiah 49, verses 1 through 4, you knew me, you knew my name, you knew me when the mission you sent me on. In fact, the term called in verse number 1 refers to a divine commission. God has given us a divine commission to carry out work, one that was in the mind of God from eternity past. He's now bringing it to pass. God told Jeremiah in Jeremiah 1:15, you're going to be a prophet to the nations, not to the nation, to the nations. And because he was called, here Jeremiah, and we're learning in this text in Isaiah, Jesus was called as Messiah to be a light for the Gentiles. The phrase "made mention of my name" in Isaiah 49:1 speaks to God's elective intent. He knew what he wanted him to do, and he knew who he was, and he knew the name by which he would call him to do that work or to carry out that assignment. As Jesus ministered on earth, especially to his own people, Israel, there were times when his work seemed like it was in vain. And then we see this from the prophecy here in Isaiah 49:4. Have you ever felt like the things that you were doing, nobody was listening? That all the labor, all the efforts you put forth to witness to somebody, they don't hear you? Well, doesn't mean you stop. You keep saying it. You keep repeating it. But Jesus ministered on earth to his own people, and they did not hear him. They did not receive him. Don't be upset when that happens. There are many times churches, they'll listen to another pastor before they'll listen to their own. The religious leaders opposed him. The disciples did not always understand him. And the people that he helped did not always thank him. But it didn't stop him from doing what he was doing. Jesus came with a divine intent. He came with purpose in mind to carry out the will of God. And with that purpose in mind, even when people don't understand you, even when people oppose you, even when there's no thanks for it, you keep on because you know what the calling is. Jesus lived and he labored by faith, and God gave him success. Just as he did with Jesus, so he does with us. When we are given assignment by God and we faithfully pursue it, we're not concerned with how it's received or the applause. We're concerned with God saying, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. Keep doing it. Stay in the fight. Stay in the race." Secondly, not only do we see him as a servant, the Messiah is shown as a savior in this text of Isaiah chapter 49, verses 5 through 10. He's a savior for all people. The words "and now" in verse number 5 indicate that the servant is about to provide a further declaration, an elaboration of his purpose and calling. "And now, I've told you this," 1 through 4, "and now," listen, he begins by reiterating his calling. He says he was formed from the womb to be God's servant. That's what God said to Jeremiah as well, Jeremiah 1. And that's what God is declaring to you and I too. And when we're in our mother's wombs, God already had purpose for us. We come out and have the opportunity to exercise our volition or God's volition. "Thy will be done," or "our will be done." He's reiterated his calling, and he reiterated his mission. His mission was to bring Jacob again to God. Jacob was another word for Israel. He was trying to bring, his call to bring Jacob back to Israel, to God. He was the patriarch whose name was changed. Remember Jacob, the son of the lineage that would be used by God to carry forth the great message of Christ. Esau, Jacob, they were sons, and they were brothers rather. And Jacob, his name was changed to Israel. He fathered the 12 tribes of the nation of Israel. The use of this name here emphasizes the close attachment of the Lord and his servant to his people. God is closely attached to us. Jesus has attachment to us. And because of that attachment, there's a real intimacy that he has. He understands us. He understands what we're thinking. He understands our feelings. He understands our reprehensions that we have. Christ understands all of that. And so the close attachment that he has in the text, this servant is meant to carry out God's purpose to the people of God. The servant of the Lord asserts his confidence that although the people are not yet responding, although they still haven't started to adjust themselves to what God wanted, he will still receive glory and he'll still receive strength from God in spite of what people do. So you don't lose faith. You don't lose heart. We don't quit because of what people do. We still know we're going to receive the glory of God and strength from God to carry out his assignments. You and I, must never forget that salvation is of the Jews. The Bible tells it in John 44:22. That's the truth. And that when our Lord first came, he didn't minister to Gentiles until first he ministered to the Jews. But there came a time in Matthew, right before we head from 12 into 13, that he went out of the house and he went and he sat down by the sea. Sea is another term for Gentiles, or speaking of those who were not of Jewish birth. He left out of the house and went by the sea. He came to minister to all people. Salvation is of the Jews, but it is meant for everyone. When our Lord returned to heaven, he left behind a believing remnant of Jews that carried on his work. Y'all remember that in Acts chapter 1, there was about 125 people that met in the upper room. And this small group of people, from that group that met there in prayer to the time of the day of Pentecost, they stayed in prayer in one accord. When Pentecost happened in one accord, God did something dynamic. He sent forth a helper, the Holy Spirit, that came down with great power. This small group of people, you don't need a lot of people, listen, doing what God has bid to be done. All you need is a faithful few people that will trust God with the power that he's sending to do the work. The Bible is a Jewish book. The first believers and missionaries were Jews. And the Gentiles would not have heard the gospel had it not been for the Jews that came from Israel, those men, those disciples of Jesus, those that all on the day of Pentecost, when the fire came down upon them, the Holy Spirit came and they spoke with other languages. Messiah was despised by both Jew and by Gentile, Isaiah 49:7. But he still did God's work and he was glorified. No matter what anybody says about you, keep on trusting. Keep on trucking, as the song used to say. Keep on believing. Keep on carrying out God's purpose. He was a servant, and he was a savior. But he's also the source. He's the bringer of peace. Direct your attention, wasn't in our reading, down to Isaiah chapter 49, verse 22. Thus saith the Lord God, behold, I will lift up mine hand to the Gentiles, and set up my standard to the people, and they shall bring thy sons in their arms, and thy daughters shall be carried upon thy shoulders, their shoulders. We learn that the Gentiles and Jews will one day no longer be enemies. They will no longer be at odds this day that was prophetically spoken about by Isaiah the prophet. I'm not talking about today. I'm talking about prophetic words that's listed here. Instead, the rulers of the Gentiles will be of one mind with Israel and will lend aid to her. Now remember, Israel went into Babylonian captivity, and God would use a Gentile as a leader of the Gentiles to bring them out of that captivity. This is clearly not a compelled cooperation, but it is a genuinely close relationship born out of transformed lives. When our lives are transformed, we don't operate and do things the way we did before we were transformed. There was a certain way I did things in business before I got the salvation power of God in my life. But once that came, I don't do it the same way anymore. A transformed life does things differently. So this text, this ruler of the Gentiles, appears to be a foreshadow of the kindness that King Cyrus of Persia, he's the one who brought them out of the Babylonian captivity. He's the one who brought it to an end. You learn in 2 Chronicles chapter 36 and in Ezra chapter 1 and Ezra 5. This is the work of God through this Gentile that he's going to bring about a change for his people. Prophetically, in Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 14, Paul refers to the wall that existed between Jew and Gentiles. And he says it was torn down by Christ. When Messiah comes, he not only comes as servant, not only as savior, he is the source of peace between men. Whenever people find themselves can't get along and there's a wall up between them, the question has to be asked is, where is Christ in all of that division? Because Christ took down walls of separation. He takes down walls of broken communication. He takes down walls that would lift somebody up and think that they're better than other people. Christ takes that down. The servant of the Lord, the Savior, Messiah, fulfilled a great mission through his death and resurrection, and will also be the source of peace between God and man between people who were once, at one time seemed like we were irreconcilable to God. Jesus is the one, he brought that peace between us and God. And the peace of God, when you have it, you can't understand how it comes about. It passes all understanding, as the Bible says. That peace won't let us be anxious about things because we're trusting in God. Although it is not part of our lesson, reading Isaiah 49:13 declares, "The Lord comforts his people and will have compassion on his afflicted ones." It's from the NIV. God comforts his people. Whenever you and I are going through a crisis, all we got to do is look up, open our eyes and look up. God is right there to give us comfort. God is there to tell us that things are not as bad as we think. God is there and says, "Why are you fearful? Why are you so shaky about what I'm going to do? Why aren't you trusting me?" God says, "I comfort my people, and I have compassion on those who are afflicted." Not comprehending the loving judgments of God, the Bible says in verse 14, the people wailed. "The Lord has forsaken me, and my Lord has forgotten me." Beloved, just because we're going through a little suffering right now, does that mean that God does not know us? I love that song, "God has not forgot." If he said he'll do it, it'll come to pass. God has not forgot. God has not forgot. God has not forgot us. We can cry, we can wail, we can pray. He has not forgotten us. He has not forsaken us. This God who is the source of peace should be giving a comfort to us even right now. However, the Lord assures them of his love by comparing himself to a compassionate mother, verses 14 to 23 of our lesson. It's not part of our reading. He says he's a compassionate mother. He says, "I'm a courageous warrior," verses 24 to 26. He says, "I'm a constant lover," chapter 50, verses 1 through 3. As the source of peace, we know that God has compassion on us just like a mother has for her children. We know that God is a warrior that has great courage, and he won't push back and back down from anything. We know that God is a constant lover. He's a keeper, and he's a lover of our souls. He's compassionate, and he comforts us as a mother comforts her children. In his compassion, he would set the captives free. In his compassion, he is forever protecting us from Babylon, physically, figuratively speaking. The invasion against our lives, the things that pull us away from trusting God. God has compassion to help us. He's compassionate to help us. Israel was married to Jehovah when they accepted the covenant at Sinai, Exodus chapter 19 and Exodus chapter 20. They were married to him. And Hosea tells us, God is married to the backslider. Now, backslider is not a term we find in the New Testament. But to the people of Israel, God called them backsliders. They pushed back against God. He was the source of peace, even to people who have pushed back against him. So the question becomes, beloved, knowing that he is a servant, knowing that he is a savior, and knowing that he is the source or the bringer of peace, we come to this place where we come to a crossroad in life. And the question I want to ask you this morning is, which road are you going to take? Are you going to take the road that leads down to death and destruction? And as long as you're not walking with God and you're bound by the things of this life and of this world, then you are headed on a downward spiral. Death and destruction awaits those who are not walking with God. Are you going to take that road down? Are you going to be bound by sin? And I hope you notice the chains. His hands are bound and his legs are bound. Hands are bound, you can't do anything. Legs are bound, you can't walk, you can't run. That road to death, it's a slow walk. Bound up, people head in that direction. And they make a choice whether they want to keep going down or whether they want to trust God and take another direction. Or you can take the road up to liberty, to joy, and to freedom. This life, the song Andre Cross used to sing, "Living this kind of life gets sweeter and sweeter day by day." There's so much liberty, there's so much joy, there's so much freedom in serving Christ. And so, am I bound by sin, my hands tied and my feet tied, headed on a road to death and destruction? Or do I want to go in a different direction of liberty, joy, and freedom? And notice, my hands are not tied anymore. I'm freed by the Son. My feet are not bound anymore. I can run and I can dance. Take the shackles off my feet so I can dance. I can rejoice. I can lift my hands in the sanctuary. I don't need somebody to tell me to lift my hands. I rejoice because of the glory that belongs to God. I'm freed by the Son. Notice the two people. One is going down on the road to death and destruction. The other is going up on the road of liberty, joy, and freedom. One has his hands released and his feet released. I want to go back though to how did that guy heading toward liberty, joy, and freedom get free? Well, it happened, and there's two things that's involved. It has to do with the I or the O. It has to do with the I or the O. When I determine my course, when I do what I think is good, when I live by what my own desires and hearts are, I'm headed down. When I becomes more important than God. But if I believe, replace that I with an O, it's the Son that gives direction to my life. The Son of God directing me. And what he did to make me free was a marvelous thing. He freed me when he freed himself from the cross. Those chains were broken. When he released himself from the cross of Calvary, the chains were broken. He was now made free. Since he was made free, you and I were free. So the difference is the cross and the Savior. Without this cross and the Savior, I'm headed down and I'm bound. And I determine everything that's going on in my life. When the Son makes me free, it's the O, the Son. He becomes the difference in my life, and I can rejoice. I pray that you choose the right road today, and it's an easy choice. And take this moment right now for those listening at the Church School Hour. Before you go any further, you can choose Christ. You can choose the right road this morning. If you're sitting there, you just stop by to visit with somebody and the broadcast is on. You can choose the road up or you can choose the road down. You decide. I'm going to pray with you so that you can make that choice. God, we thank you for those who are listening today. And if there's anyone, Lord, who needs to make a decision about you, I pray, God, you have shown them that as long as they're bound, their hands are bound, they cannot work for you. And their feet are bound, they cannot run for you. But God, when you take the shackles off, when I remove the I and give me the O of the Son of your Son, Jesus, I am made free from the things that had me bound. Oh, Father, I pray that when that decision is made today, you will give the person who made that decision instructions on how to walk closer with you. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus is the only Savior. And if this lesson has been a blessing to you, we want to help you to further grow in this lesson. Here's some things. I want you to just, for your own learning, what is the significance of the sharp sword in Isaiah 49:2? This is part of your lesson. Why is the Messiah called Israel in verse 3? You got to know that. How does the servant of the Lord demonstrate his faith? Even those of us who are serving God, we have to demonstrate faith in what God says. How did the Messiah's own nation respond to him? Did they come running to him? Did they trust him? Or did they push back from him? What covenant does the servant of the Lord make with God? The servant of the Lord, what covenant does he make? And in what ways does the Messiah bring peace through his redeeming work? These questions, as you're dealing with them this week, from our lesson, will help you grow in our knowledge of the Lord Savior Jesus the Christ. We want you to know that this lesson is available online. Just a correction, there's a tab that it says Church School. You'll click on the Church School tab, and right underneath the lesson, there'll be a PDF there you can download. Please, we ask if you'd give adherence to that. It'd be beneficial to you that if you'd like to download this lesson, I've been saying all along, email me, I'll send you a copy. Now you can go right up on our website, www.cbcburlingtonnj.org, and click under Church School, go to the lesson for today, and you can download the lesson. It's available to anyone who'd like to have it. Make copies, give to your neighbors and your friends. Thank you for joining us today. I pray you'll stay around with us for our worship service at 10 o'clock. Have a blessed Lord's Day. And remember, Christ is the light to the Gentiles. He is the only Savior that you and I can have that will bring us from darkness into light. God, thank you for this day. Thank you for this lesson. Bless your people and all who heard it, and be glorified in it. We look forward, oh God, as you meet us in our time of worship at 10 a.m. In the name of Jesus we pray, and we thank you, God. Amen. Have a blessed morning.